very good scientists, some very good people, experts in climate change or food security or many of the issues that are involved with the summit that's going on, the politics of the summit that is going on, and the people that are gathering here today in Bonn. And you understand already that this is an important occasion that will hopefully have global impact. We're about the business of trying to save the planet that we live in. It's no small task, and a very complicated task. You just heard from Father Pedro, you just heard that there are scientific issues, there are political issues, social issues, international issues, and so on. Difficult issues to grapple with. I want to encourage you to use Laudato Si, this small book, as your Bible, as a handbook to take with you into the future. I left my copy before coming here, so I don't have it here. I can't pull it out and show you. You have to have your own copy in your Bible. But I encourage you to read this because it is very rich, and it is a platform. It is a proposal for how we might, human beings, how we might not only save the planet, but how we might actually save each other in the process. I want to start, though, with a story. It's a new story. This happened, perhaps you remember, the Pope, this Pope Francis, who was responsible for Laudato Si, he chose very early in his time as Pope to go to Jerusalem, to go to the Holy City. And you know this is a place that is a very difficult place politically. It's also the home, the founding city, of three major religions. So, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, all there in the city of Jerusalem. It is a sacred city to all three religions. And you know, historically, it is a very difficult place because of the tensions among those religious groups. The state of Israel and the proposed state of Palestine are both in tension over who owns the land, who should control the land. It has layers and layers of problems. But the Pope wanted to go, and so he arranged for a trip there. When he got there, he was highly, as we say, scripted. He would do this, and then he would do this, and then he would do this. The Jewish state, the state of Israel, was very concerned that they controlled his time because of all of these potential conflicts. And when the Pope landed, he immediately began changing his schedule. He began taking over his schedule. And you know, as a head of state, he's the head of the Vatican State. He's also the head of the Catholic religion, the most esteemed Christians. And in here, he was a guest of the Jewish state. There was a lot of potential tension. He immediately said everyone at ease, but he did his own thing, as we say, when he got to Israel. And so, typically, you do things when you're the head of state, you go to the wall of the temple, the most holy site for Jews. You pray at the wall of the temple. And so he did that. There's also a section where the Muslims pray. And he respected that he should not go there because he was a guest of the Jewish state. But on the way to another town, he saw the wall that divides Israel from Palestine. that was built by the Jews, by the Jewish state. And he told the driver to stop. And the driver stopped. A long row of official vehicles with other important people on this caravan going to another town. And he got out by that wall and he prayed against that wall. You know, the Jews put their heads up against the wall and they pray at the wall. It's a sign of devotion. He prayed at the Palestinian wall. And the trip was clearly in his hands. He was clearly managing the trip, this visit. When he left Israel, he had spoken very frankly to the leaders of the Jewish community, to the leaders of the Christian community, and to the leaders of the Islamic community, the Muslim community, about their need to get along, about their need to compromise, about their need to understand each other. And he begged them to keep talking. He didn't give them solutions, he just begged them to keep talking, because he said, I believe that if you keep talking and working together, and one of the things you should work on are the poor people, because you all have poor people, and the poor people here deserve a better life than the life you're giving them. He's very honest about that. And there were refugees there that he took with him back to Rome. He took several families of refugees, mother, father, children, took them with him and brought them back to Rome. And he told the Italian authorities, you have to make them citizens. You have to bring them in and we have to make them citizens. They're refugees. They had fled Syria, in fact. Why do I tell you this simple story? Because I think this Holy Father is an excellent example for us about the virtues we need if we are going to become the kind of citizens of the world who are able to stay in relationship. Relationship with the environment, relationship with one another, relationship even with ourselves. The Pope is a man of integrity. He speaks truth to power. He does not shy away from scientific fact, from political fact. At the same time, he sees beyond this. He's a man of imagination. He's not only a man of integrity, but he's a man of great imagination. He's also a man of inclusion. Everyone deserves a place at our table. Everyone deserves a chance for a full, complete life. And we all deserve that from one another, and we all deserve to treat our planet better than we're treating it. And he is a man of initiative. He's a man who will do things. He's a man who will, as we say in English, walk the walk if you're going to talk the talk. If you're going to speak about something, you have to be able to do something about what you say. These qualities, integrity, facing the truth, allowing the truth to face us, allowing ourselves to hear the truth. This quality of imagination, can we dream of something bigger than what we have? Can we dream of something better than what we have? Is it possible to create a society that, in fact, includes everyone? This idea of everyone has a right to be at the table. And finally, can we act? Can we give ourselves the courage to do something? Even the little things. He took three families. It was a little bit. He said that's all we could fit on the plane. But he took three families and he brought them back with him to Rome to get them out of a land where they had no home, where they had no property, where they had no future. Those four qualities are the qualities that this man, Francis, brought to Laudato Si. It is a work that that is full of integrity. It respects science. It respects politics. It respects truth from many forms. It respects the gospel truth. It is a very imaginative work. It's the first thing like it. People are reading it and using it who have nothing to do with Catholicism and Christianity. They're using it as their own Bible for the future. It is a work of inclusion. It says everyone must be involved. You must be involved, I must be involved, our systems must be involved, our organizations must be involved at the local level, at the international level, at the national level. We must include everyone in this project. And as you can see, it is a work of great, great initiative. He wants us to do something, even the little things. So I encourage you to take your Laudato Si book and bring it with you to the future. Because the future needs the people of you, especially our young people. It needs young people who are willing to be bold, who are willing to be revolutionary, if you will, who are willing to be prophetic, speak truth to power. And without that, and a little humility, knowing it's just me, but it's something, and I can do something. And if I do something, I am contributing to a bigger project, to a better world. That humility will be what we need to keep ourselves from hurting one another as well as hurting our planet. So that's my message to you this morning. Never to take your little Bible with you without the sea. Find a copy. Oh, here it is. Good. It's not my copy, obviously, I told you. But you need a copy like this. This is in English. I'm sure there are copies in German. There's copies in other languages. So thank you, and thank you for being here, and thank you for your interest in this subject and in this world that we all share together. Thank you.